many electronic product development projects, thermal problems just happen. You are, with your design, nicely moving forward in the development funnel, going from concept to implementation, and then, all of a sudden, a thermal problem crashes in. And before you know it, you are confronted with large cost late stage changes. So why are thermal problems so disruptive? Well, thermal problems are so disruptive because they always happen at the end of a project when your time is up and your budget is spent. So why is this always at the end of a project? Well, because they always happen at system integration. And why do they always happen at system integration? Because there is no problem before system integration. Why? Because three different groups independently make the heat, the cooling, and the requirements. And of these three, you can only choose two. So by law of physics, there's a relation between the heat production, the amount of cooling that you can do, as expressed in a thermal resistance R, and the temperature rise above ambient. And in a typical product development, heat production is the domain of the electrical and software departments. Temperature requirements are the domain of quality and product management. And heat removal is in the hands of the mechanical department. So, there is a need to predict in the concept phase, way before system integration, if a thermal concept can work. My name is Wendy Luiten, and I deliver the training Electronics Cooling and Thermal Design at the High Tech Institute. Predicting if a concept can work is one of the main topics of my training. So, how's the training set up? We start with looking at what the product should do. So, we look at specifications and requirements and translate the system requirements to the thermal requirements. Then, we look into how are we going to realize the filling of this thermal function. For this, we look at applied physics of heat transfer, the thermal V module, as you can see in the box, with the box at the system level, and then board and components at subsystem and component level. And, very important, we capture the design in a thermal circuit model. With this thermal circuit model, we can look if the design works. How? We calculate the relevant temperatures, compare these with the requirements, and this will give us an idea of a gap. If there is a gap, we go into the mode of thermal problem solving and applying cooling solutions. And once there is a concept that works, you can go into verification, and the training will touch upon thermal simulations and thermal measurement. I had already discussed the thermal circuit model. This is a very high-level lumped model to calculate this system thermal resistance. It is usually Excel-based, that makes it very fast and parametric. And this is also important pre-work if advanced thermal simulations are needed in a later stage of development. An example of such a circuit model is shown in the blue box at the bottom. To the left, you see a system layout, the mechanical layout of an LED product, and to the right, you see the corresponding circuit network. In the training, you get either 5 online sessions or 3 face-to-face sessions, and the face-to-face session obviously are longer. And there's a mix of theory and exercises. For the theory, there's a theory reader containing over 400 slides that are divided over 16 modules, touching on topics of thermal physics, electronics cooling applications, and a lot of step-by-step recipes for ways of working. The exercises are supported by the exercise reader containing more than 18 worked exercises. And there are also 2 complete case studies in the training that come from my industrial practice. At the end of this training, participants will be able to translate system requirements into thermal requirements. they're able to make a thermal circuit model and predict and prevent likely thermal problems. They can provide input to thermal computer simulations if such are needed, and they can assess the results of thermal simulations and thermal measurements. And participants can include, but are absolutely not limited to, mechanical design engineers, electrical engineers, system architects, and people from the thermal supply base. My name is Wendy Luiten. I look forward to seeing you in my training, Electronics Cooling and Thermal Design, at the High Tech Institute. Thank you for listening.